One thing that's becoming somewhat of a concern. And that is misinformation. It's being posted on social media sites. It is important to know. That we have discussed with federal authority. That these issues are crimes. They will be investigated. Statewide and federally. And prosecution will take place. When people perpetrating this information are identified. So any of that information and people that are putting that information up there. In any manner, all right, that can be construed as a violation of state or federal law, will be prosecuted, will be investigated and prosecuted.
Perfect, thank you.
If you really want enlightenment, then just lighten up.
We have seen their kind before. They are the heirs of all the murderous ideologies of the 20th century. By sacrificing human life to serve their radical visions, by abandoning every value except the will to power, they follow in the path of fascism, Nazism, and totalitarianism. And they will follow that path all the way to where it ends, in history's unmarked grave of discarded lies. Every nation, in every region, now has a decision to make. Either you are with us, or you are with the terrorists.
George really said a whopper there, didn't he? The first time I heard this, I thought, I guess we don't have any choice but to be with him then. After all, if we are with us, then we're with him, and if we are with the terrorists, then we are with him. They're one and the same. So, but I found a third option.
Warning, viewer discretion is advised. You are going to see the evidence that President Obama knowingly and consciously orders the murder of men, women, and children.
Greetings, citizens of the world. Together we are Anonymous. There has been a rumor being spread around for years. This rumor has made a select few millions, even billions of dollars while they spread fear, trick people into buying things they don't need, and misrepresent an entire culture. This is the rumor that the Mayans predicted the end of the world will take place on December 21st, 2012. In reality, the Mayans did make a prediction for the end of their calendar. They predicted the start of a new era, when a new calendar would take the old one's place, an era of knowledge, peace and love. The media has twisted the true Mayan predictions into one of death, destruction and devastation simply because it makes a good story. They spread this rumor partly for ratings, they spread it partly for money, and they spread it ultimately for power. It's impossible to honestly say the world won't end the 21st of December 2012. However, the world is just as likely to end today as it is on the 21st. With that being said, it is possible to honestly say the real Mayan predictions could be right, but only if you want them to be. As this message is being heard around the world, there is an operation going on called Project Mayhem 2012. It aims to create the very thing the Mayans predicted would happen on December 21st, 2012. It aims to expose corruption, to give humanity the knowledge needed to secure peace and love for many generations to come.
Signs death orders where entire weddings or village gatherings are bombed by drones and other aircraft, knowing that children would be killed, and simply calling them collateral damage, dehumanizing them down to the word collateral damage. Think of the magnitude of that. We're going to show you the mainstream news articles where they admit he signs death orders to kill people in cars with their children. Even in the fictional Scarface, Tony Montana won't blow up the car when there's little kids in the back of it.
I need a maid car to come to the microphone, so we'll listen to that.
My name is Robbie Parker.
Project Mayhem 2012 relies on you to be successful. You're the past, present, and future of humanity, and only humanity as a whole can secure true peace. That means all of us, no matter what race, age, gender, religion, or sexuality. We are all humans. The time has come for us to unite, to understand that we are all brothers and sisters living on a tiny blue planet in a vast ocean of wonders. The choice is yours to make.
You got to be really evil to do this. And we've just gotten to where it's passe, it's no big deal. And he has massively increased the drone strikes, even since the warmonger George W. Bush. And it is sickening and disgusting that Democrats, because he was given a peace prize, why not give Hitler one or Stalin? Because he's trendy, he's liberal, he's supposedly black. It's cool when he kills people and destroys Libya and now uses Al-Qaeda against Syria. It's so sick. And then you have that as a backdrop while he gets up there and fake cries and says, we've got to ban guns. And he's assigned a new task force that outside of Congress is going to call to ban guns. And Reuters says, be a dictator, Obama. They came out today. Use executive orders and take people's semi-autos. They don't need that for hunting. It's not for hunting. It's to protect ourselves from tyranny. And it's just so over the top, because with Bush, it was bad enough, but he was just a warmonger. With Obama, you get to hear about how he's like Mahatma Gandhi and Martin Luther King rolled into one, and he's this man of peace. And it's so loving what he's doing, and it's sick. So we're going to show you just some, in just a few countries, of the documented dead children where the Pentagon admits they killed them.
And my family is one of the families that lost a child yesterday in the Sandy Hook Elementary School shootings here in Connecticut.
We are going to have to take meaningful action. We have endured too many of these tragedies.
Newtown. It doesn't even seem real. It just does not seem like it's even possible. It's like,
something has to be done. When is it going to get so bad that lawmakers, people in Washington will address what's happened?
They did walk a guy out of the woods. I saw him walk a guy out earlier with handcuffs. He walked by us and said he didn't do it.
It was a grown man.
A grown man, yeah. He's sitting in the front of the police car over there now. So, I mean,
he didn't have a gun?
No, I didn't see any gun. Just had him handcuffed. And he walked by us and looked into parents' eyes and said, I didn't do it.
How you can let humanity continue to suffer, or you can see the truth. You can realize war, greed, and corruption are no way for a species to survive. They are not the ideas of the future for humanity. Brothers and sisters of humanity, this is your chance to give peace a chance. Together we can make a difference. Never let anyone tell you otherwise. One day you're going to look back and reflect on the choices you made. What would you like to tell your grandchildren? That you sat by while the world burned? Or would you like to tell them that you, that all of humanity, stood together in both our darkest and brightest hours, as a united force for peace, knowledge, and progress?
It starts with Obama giving a speech about loving children. It's totally hollow and hypocritical. And then it moves through just some of the children he has directly ordered be killed. And then it just shows some simple mainstream news article photos. But again, because of the context we're putting it in, his hypocrisy, The censors will try to block you seeing something that ended the Vietnam War and could end all of these undeclared illegal wars. We're trying to save children here. Not just the children killed at Sandy Hook, the 20, but the thousands killed by these illegal wars. And so everyone who really cares about children and just doesn't want to buy into the hype in the name of banning guns needs to get this video out to everyone they know. This is a very important piece put together by Rob Due. The system does not want you to see it, so save it, burn it on disc, show it on local access television, and get it out on every video channel on the web. And when YouTube censors, like they've done in the past, we will simply use their attack on free speech and the truth as a way to get it out to even more people.
Was he dressed?
Camo pants with a dark jacket.
A camo pants with a dark jacket.
They're up all on the second floor, and I didn't get there today.
Sure.
And it's my sensibilities may not be the average man. Firearms than most pathologists, but if I say it in court, they yell at me and don't make me answer. So I let the police deal with that. Dangerous.
But you said it was the long rifle that was used?
Yes.
Sure. But the long rifle was discovered in the car. That's not correct.
Not correct, sir.
Follow up on that question.
I don't know. There were lots of them. Okay. If you can control the situation, depending on your photographer, and I have very good photographers, no, I don't.
How young?
Sorry, I don't.
How young was the youngest victim?
I don't.
How young?
Sorry, I don't.
How young was?
Y'all gonna have to look at the spreadsheet when we pass it out. I'm sorry.
Did the gunman kill himself with the rifle?
No. I don't know yet. I'll examine him tomorrow morning.
Precision from the shooter, or was it spread randomly?
Both. It's a very difficult question to answer. Okay. You'd think after the thousands of people I've seen shot, I could answer that question, but if I attempted to answer it in court, there'd be an objection and they'd win. They're wearing kid stuff.
Doctor, the children that you autopsied, where on the body were they wearing?
All over.
How many boys and how many girls?
I have no idea. It's H. Wayne, W-A-Y-N-E. Carver, C-A-R-V-E-R. And it's the second. And that's why I don't use the H, because when my father asked my grandfather, he said, fine, but as long as you never call him Harold. It wasn't a tent. It was this magnificent thing. We have three vehicles and a lot of guys to drive them. Actually... One of the highlights of my administration is that we make them as nondescript and unmarked as possible. Just to foil you guys.
Look at it, that means you don't have evidence.
I just...
You don't know.
I
you gotta check it.
They're up all on the second floor, and I didn't get there today. Sorry, I don't.
How young was he?
Both. As long as you never call him Harold.
Choose carefully and wisely. Humanity's future relies on your answer. If your answer is yes, that you want to see peace, then you need to make your voice heard. Don't sit around and wait for peace to occur, because it won't unless we're all actively taking part in the pursuit of it. If you agree with this message, like it, share it, re-upload it, spread it around everywhere you can, make it viral, or make other content spreading this idea and make those viral. Above all else, please believe in yourself and not in a group, person, or even an idea, because believing in an idea is pointless unless you believe in yourself first. Together we are humanity, we are anonymous. We are legion. We are united as one, divided by zero. We can and should forgive, while we never forget. Expect yourself, then expect us.
We use the enemy's actions against them. So here is the report.
We gather here in memory of 20 beautiful children.
They were cute kid stuff. It wasn't a tent. It was this magnificent thing. Sorry, I don't.
How young was he?
Yes, sir. One question.
Does the mother of the shooter have any connection to the school?
Yes, sir. One question.
Does the mother of the shooter have any connection to the school?
Now, you have to understand that after the shooting, we did a complete and thorough search of the entire area, the neighborhood. With our local partners, everything was examined. If we found anyone that was in the woods cutting wood, they would be detained pending the investigation. So there were no other arrests that were associated with this investigation that occurred. Okay.
Sir, what about the mindset?
Yes, sir. One question.
Does the mother of the shooter have any connection to the school?
Police State News.
One thing that's becoming somewhat of a concern, and that is misinformation is being posted on social media sites.
Six remarkable adults. They lost their lives in a school that could have been any school. In a quiet town full of good and decent people that could be any town in America.
It is important to note that we have discussed with federal authorities that these issues are crimes. They will be investigated statewide and federally, and prosecution will take place when people perpetrating this information are identified.
Here in Newtown, I come to offer the love and prayers of a nation. I can only hope it helps for you to know that you're not alone in your grief. That our world too has been torn apart. That all across this land of ours, we have wept with you. We've pulled our children tight. And you must know that whatever measure of comfort we can provide, we will provide. As a community, you've inspired us, Newtown. In the face of indescribable violence, in the face of unconscionable evil.
So any of that information and people that are putting that information up there in any manner, all right, that can be construed as a violation of state or federal law, will be prosecuted, will be investigated and prosecuted.
It's a very complicated problem, but perhaps this will be the day starting with the president, Washington finally got serious about trying to do something about this.
You've looked out for each other. You've cared for one another. You've loved one another. This is how Newtown will be remembered. And with time and God's grace, that love will see you through. But we as a nation, we are left with some hard questions. And we learned that our most important job is to give them what they need to become self-reliant and capable and resilient, ready to face the world without fear. And we know we can't do this by ourselves.
Mass shootings, victims, children, inexplicable horror, suggesting to the country that he is prepared to take action and perhaps political risks he hasn't before to confront and change the underlying dynamics that brought this tragedy and this grueling historic day to the briefing room and the rest of the country.
He was also, Jay Carney specifically asked about whether assault weapons ban, whether that remains a commitment of the president, and the answer was yes, yes, it does remain. It does remain a
commitment of his. Camo pants with a dark jacket.
Two shooters were initially believed involved in the mass shooting. One of those shooters, now dead. What's not been confirmed is whether or not that gunman took his own life or whether or not there was something that ensued after authorities began arriving at the scene. And now the big question will be, is there in fact that second shooter, and where is that second shooter?
There were reports, you touched on it earlier, Trace touched on it earlier, of a possible accomplice. And there was some tape of police. Look at the pictures. There were reports of a second person, perhaps an accomplice, and then we didn't hear much more about that. First we'd heard that they had been pushed off of that, and now we're getting more reports, unconfirmed as of this hour, Rick, but we're getting more reports now from other sources that a second person may be in custody. Have the police said anything about whether they believe that piece of the investigation is still open?
Well, what we had heard was that there was a potential second suspect. You know, oftentimes after these major incidents, you'll have a lot of reports, and many of them turn out to be false. A lot of times there's confusion in the midst of things, and someone may be running from the scene who may be escaping with their life, and people might think that that person is running because they're fleeing the scene because they're somehow involved. We don't know. We're waiting for police to arrive here at this park to brief us and give us more information on the shooting itself. We've been told that there is no active investigation, no active search for a second shooter. That could mean that they have already captured a second person if someone was involved, but we haven't been able to confirm that yet, Megan.
But whether there is still an active search underway for a second gunman, that's the question, and that may have something to do with that helicopter aerial shot of the woods.
It comes as a shock at a certain point where you realize, no matter how much you love these kids, you can't do it by yourself. That this job of keeping our children safe and teaching them well is something we can only do together, with the help of friends and neighbors, the help of a community, and the help of a nation. And in that way, we come to realize that we bear responsibility for every child, because we're counting on everybody else to help look after ours. That we're all parents, that they're all our children. This is our first task, caring for our children. It's our first job. If we don't get that right, we don't get anything right. That's how, as a society, we will be judged. And by that measure, can we truly say, as a nation, that we're meeting our obligations? Can we honestly say that we're doing enough to keep our children, all of them, safe from harm? Can we claim as a nation that we're all together there, letting them know that they're loved and teaching them to love in return? Can we say that we're truly doing enough to give all the children of this country the chance they deserve to live out their lives in happiness and with purpose? Reflecting on this the last few days, and if we're honest with ourselves, The answer is no. We're not doing enough. We will have to change. Since I've been president, this is the fourth time we have come together to comfort a grieving community torn apart by mass shootings. Fourth time we've hugged survivors. Fourth time we've consoled the families of victims.
This is something we're going to have to do. We're going to have to take some action. This has happened too many times. We'll see in the days ahead what that amounts to. But, you know, people don't talk about trying to get these guns out of the hands of these emotionally disturbed people. And, you know, when people talk about guns...
are going forward.
Some of the early reports suggested there might be multiple gunmen. Have you seen anything to verify that, or are we just talking about one shooter here who is dead?
I've heard that same report. I don't have any information that would either confirm it, you know, or dispel that report.
He was also, Jay Carney specifically asked about whether assault weapons ban, whether that remains a commitment of the president. The answer was yes, it does remain. It does remain.
It does remain a commitment of his.
We have our temple service every Sunday. Starts around 10:30, and usually goes in the afternoon. And around 10, between 10 and 10:30, for white males who were dressed darkly, dressed in all black clothing, came in and opened fire on the on our congregation. And from what I'm told, about 20 to 25 people have been hit. And my uncle was one of them. He's been taken to the hospital.
Some of the eyewitnesses tend to have wrong information.
Law-abiding citizens to surrender their firearms in a nationwide roundup and meltdown of all semi-automatic firearms and pump-action rifles and shotguns. 640,000 ordinary conventional firearms confiscated and destroyed. The anti-gun forces can no longer escape. Armed robberies have skyrocketed, up 69%. Assaults involving guns rose 28%. Gun murders increased 19%. And a new phenomenon, home invasions jumped 21%. An increase politicians insist they can't explain because they're still trying to legally define what a home invasion is.
Mexico has strict gun control. You cannot own a gun in Mexico. And they had 20,000 people dead last year in the drug cartel war. Because I was in the Philippines physically the day Ferdinand Marcos declared martial law and made himself a dictator. And the first thing that dictator did, he gave the people of the Philippines 2 weeks to turn in all their guns or it was the death penalty. Now, why would a dictator do that? Why would he make his number one priority when he took over as dictator to disarm the public? The Second Amendment is there, so, and it was put in there not for hunting and fishing, like they like to say, because back when they did it, if you didn't hunt or fish, you didn't eat. It was put in there so the citizens would have the ability, if their government became oppressive, they could defend themselves against oppressive government. All right, how many people here die because of car accidents of drunk driving? Do we go to the Ford Motor Company and tell them stop making these automobiles because people get drunk and kill people in cars?
It's a facile argument.
It's a what?
It's a facile argument. There's no equivalence between drunk driving and lethal firearms. My point is...
Wait a minute. A car is a 2,000-pound projectile that can go 100 miles an hour.
I have no problem with an American believing that their right under the Constitution is that they can defend themselves, especially in their own home, if they're being attacked and they have a weapon.
It's also against government.
I have a big... Anyway, let's take a break.
What roll of the dice would you like? You'd prefer to be unarmed? How many people here think I make crackpot points?
Yeah.
One. How many think I make sensible points? You're in a minority, my good friend. You're the minority.
I said you made some sensible points. Let's have another audience question from Jared.
An
in between, there have been an endless series of deadly shootings across the country, almost daily reports of victims, many of them killed. Small towns and big cities all across America. Victims whose, much of the time, their only fault was being in the wrong place at the wrong time. We can't tolerate this anymore. These tragedies must end. And to end them, we must change. If there's even one step we can take to save another child, then surely we have an obligation to try. In the coming weeks, I'll use whatever power this office holds to engage my fellow citizens, from law enforcement to mental health professionals to parents and educators.
Well, well, well. Remember the Portland shooting in the mall? Remember that? How that shooter, that scary shooter, only killed two people with the scary AR-15? Well, come to find out that he was confronted by a concealed carry holder. There was a guy, 22-year-old Nick Melly, I think that's how you pronounce his last name, confronted him, but didn't shoot him because there were some friendly people behind him. But the shooter saw him take aim on him, and the shooter's next shot was to himself. So, you didn't hear that on CNN and their hysterical, hyped news coverage of the scary black rifle killing people in the mall. No, you didn't hear that. No, you had to pay attention, and later the truth came out. That's why, because I was wondering, how come they haven't talked about the mall shooting in conjunction with the shooting in Connecticut? Why? Well, how come? It turns out because it was stopped by a concealed carry guy. Alright, so I'll attach the video to this one, the news. Enjoy.
After an untold story on the shooting at Clackamas Town Center, we now know there was another armed man in the mall that day, a shopper who had the shooter in his gun sight, but never pulled the trigger. The 19's Mike Benner is live outside the mall, and Mike, the big question for many tonight would be, why didn't he shoot?
And Tracy, he understands that is a question a lot of people will be asking tonight. But Nick Mealy tells us he did not shoot because he was afraid he would injure or kill an innocent person running for safety.
Nick Mealy is emotionally drained. The 22-year-old was at the Clackamas Town Center with a friend and her four-month-old baby when a masked gunman opened fire.
I heard three shots, and I turned and looked at Casey, and I go, are you serious? And she looks at me, and she goes, yeah.
As the friend and baby hit the floor, Mealy, who has a concealed carry permit, positioned himself behind a pillar.
He was working on his rifle, and he kept pulling the charging handle and hitting the side.
The break in gunfire allowed Mealy to pull out his own gun, a Glock 22, but he never took his eyes off the shooter.
In my mind, I kept saying, like, drop it, drop the gun, you know? And when I drew up, I got tunnel vision, and all I saw was my front sight on his head, and I was indexing, and as I was going down, I was going to pull. I saw someone in the back of the Charlotte move, and I knew that if I fired and missed, I could end up hitting them.
So Mealy took cover inside a nearby store. He never did pull the trigger, and he stands by that decision.
I'm not beating myself up because I didn't shoot him, but I know that after he saw me, I think the last shot he fired was the one that he used on himself.
The gunman was dead, but not before taking two innocent lives with him, and as Mealy points out, taking the innocence of everyone else.
I don't ever want to have to see anyone that way ever. It bothers me, you know?
It just so happens that Nick Mealy is a former security guard at this mall of all places. He left in August for another security job. He tells us his ultimate goal is law enforcement. Back to you.
What a tough decision he had to make in a split second. Mike Benner, thank you.
In an effort aimed at preventing more tragedies like this. Because what choice do we have? We can't accept events like this as routine. Are we really prepared to say that we're powerless in the face of such carnage? That the politics are too hard? prepared to say that such violence visited on our children year after year after year is somehow the price of our freedom? There's only one thing we can be sure of, and that is the love that we have for our children, for our families, for each other. The warmth of a small child's embrace. That is true. The memories we have of them, the joy that they bring, the wonder we see through their eyes, that fierce and boundless love we feel for them, a love that takes us out of ourselves and binds us to something larger.
And I tried hard to be proud of my service, but all I could feel was shame. And racism could no longer mask the reality of the occupation. These were people, these were human beings. I've since been plagued by guilt anytime I see an elderly man, like the one who couldn't walk, who we rolled onto a stretcher and told the Iraqi police to take him away. I feel guilt anytime I see a mother with her children, like the one who cried hysterically and screamed that we are worse than Saddam as we forced her from her home. I feel guilt anytime I see a young girl, like the one I grabbed by the arm and dragged into the street. We were told we were fighting terrorists. The real terrorist was me, and the real terrorism is this occupation. Racism within the military has long been an important tool to justify the destruction and occupation of another country. It has long been used to justify the killing, subjugation, and torture of another people. Racism is a vital weapon employed by this government. It is more important weapon than a rifle, a tank, a bomber, or a battleship. Is more destructive than an artillery shell, or a bunker buster, or a Tomahawk missile. While those weapons are created and owned by this government, they are harmless without people willing to use them. Those who send us to war do not have to pull a trigger or lob a mortar round. They do not have to fight the war, they merely have to sell the war. They need a public who is willing to send their soldiers into harm's way. They need soldiers who are willing to kill and be killed without question. They can spend millions on a single bomb, but that bomb only becomes a weapon when the ranks in the military are willing to follow orders to use it. They can send every last soldier anywhere on earth, but there will only be a war if soldiers are willing to fight. And the ruling class, the billionaires who profit from human suffering, care only about expanding their wealth, controlling the world economy. Understand that their power lies only in their ability to convince us that war, oppression, and exploitation is in our interest. They understand that their wealth is dependent on their ability to convince the working class to die to control the market of another country. And convincing us to kill and die is based on their ability to make us think that we are somehow superior. Soldiers, sailors, Marines, airmen have nothing to gain from this occupation. The vast majority of people living in the U.S. have nothing to gain from this occupation. In fact, not only do we have nothing to gain, but we suffer more because of it. We lose limbs, endure trauma, and give our lives. Our families have to watch flag-draped coffins lowered into the earth. Millions in this country without health care, jobs, or access to education must watch this government squander over $450 million a day on this occupation. Poor and working people in this country are sent to kill poor and working people in another country to make the rich richer. And without racism, soldiers would realize that they have more in common with the Iraqi people than they do with the billionaires who send us to war. I threw families onto the street in Iraq, only to come home and find families thrown onto the street in this country, in this tragic and unnecessary foreclosure crisis. We need to wake up and realize that our real enemies are not in some distant land. They're not people whose names we don't know and cultures we don't understand. The enemy is people we know very well and people we can identify. The enemy is a system that wages war when it's profitable. The enemy is the CEOs who lay us off from our jobs when it's profitable. It's the insurance companies who deny us health care when it's profitable. It's the banks who take away our homes when it's profitable. Our enemy is not 5,000 miles away. They are right here at home. If we organize and fight with our sisters and brothers, we can stop this war, we can stop this government, and we can create a better world.
We know that's what matters. We know we're always doing right when we're taking care of them, when we're teaching them well, when we're showing acts of kindness. We don't go wrong when we do that. That's what we can be sure of. Charlotte, Daniel, Olivia, Josephine, Anna, Dylan, Madeline, Catherine, Chase, Jesse.
Trust in him with a public trust, and you know that he's human, and you don't want him to run amok. You bind him down with an oath. I know we heard talk today about someday you may see those in a uniform, in violation of their oaths, pointing the gun at you, their masters, in an unlawful way. I pray that never happens. It has happened. I want to assure you, the man in the uniform will not be I.
Law enforcement, military are not the enemy. There's a lot of people that think, oh God, we're going to have to fight the U.S. forces, we're going to have to fight the Marines, we're going to have to fight the Army. And that's not the case. The U.S. military is not against the people. We are the people.
Today, really, in many respects, our government is the one that is stepping aside the rule of law. I would say to any pastor, anyone in the military, should we have a breakdown in things in this country, stay by your Bible and stay by the Constitution. Do those things. And remember then the history of this world, the terrible debacle, from my perspective anyway, of what happened in Nazi Germany when the church did not stand by those innocent people, the Jewish people who were exterminated for no other reason than being Jewish.
My God. How did we ever allow our government to reach such a point?
What's happening to the United States is very, very sad. It's sad because we've seen it done to third world nations over and over and over again.
I would like to ask that all of you just take a moment, take a deep breath, and realize the solemn nature of this occasion, because those of you who so choose will be swearing an oath. Pretty serious proposition.
You'll never have anything in your life that's as valuable as your word. So just remember that. If we all do nothing more than fulfill our oath, then we can turn things around just on that alone.
Because it only takes a few relatively faithful servants to diffuse a lot of mischief in times of crisis. They merely hold to their oath.
If you can't swear that oath, please mentally excuse yourself and don't participate, because I, for one, intend to honor this oath, because we're in perilous times. Not quite so perilous, but perhaps far more perilous than in 1775. Please raise your hand thusly, and when you hear me say I, pronounce your own name. I, Larry Bailey, do solemnly swear or affirm that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. That I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same. That I take this obligation freely. Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, pledging my life, my fortune, and my sacred honor. So help me God.
Welcome, my brothers and sisters, to Great
Oath Keepers, an association of active duty military, police officers, and veterans, all of us who swore the oath, and will keep our oath, and will honor our oath. If you swore an oath to defend the Constitution, honor your oath by joining us, the Oath Keepers, and become an Oath Keeper.
James, Grace, Emily, Jack, Noah, Caroline, Jessica, Benjamin, Avliel, Allison. God has called them all home. For those of us who remain, let us find the strength to carry on and make our country worthy of their memory.
Kelly, I found something very interesting I wanted to share with you and just see what you think here. Let's see, we have the Homeland Security Exercise and Evaluation Program, and here is FEMA's site. I'll get it down a little. There you go. This is FEMA's site on basically planning drills. So we go over here. And we clicked on the, this is in the state of Connecticut. The Department of Emergency Services and Public Protection, Emergency Management, and Homeland Security. Now, I think this is a little funny. It's H-S-E-E-P, which is just the dyslexic version of sheep. I thought that was really funny. But the H-S-E-E-P training course, September 22nd, 2010. The training course incorporates exercise guidance and best practices from the HSEEP volumes. Throughout the course, participants will learn about exercise-related topics, including program management, design and development, conduct evaluation and improvement planning. The HSEEP training course is an interactive course. That allows participants to share personal lessons learned and best practices while gaining practical experience. In addition to the instructor-led course presentations, the course includes small group activities, videos, and group discussions. The course also provides overviews of HSEEP-related initiatives such as technology and capabilities-based planning. This blended approach will give participants hands-on experience that readily translates into real-world exercise skills. Wait a minute, real-world exercise skills? Activities include creating exercise documentation, conducting exercise planning, conferences and briefings, and practicing exercise evaluation. The course has been developed by the U.S. Department of Homeland Security, DHS, using input from federal partners, subject matters expert, SMEs, and state and local representatives. HSEEP is a capabilities-based exercise program that includes cycle mix and range of exercise activities of varying degrees, of complexity and interaction. The purpose of HSEEP is to build self-sustaining exercise programs. Oh, wait a minute. Their goal is to build these exercise programs, okay, and provide a standardized methodology for designing developing, conducting, and evaluating all exercises. Okay, all right. So they basically train them to do exercises. Participant preparation. Participants need a basic knowledge of the exercise design and HSEEP terminology. They are required to complete an independent study, introductory exercises before attending the training course. This IS course takes approximately 3 to 5 hours to complete. To complete the requirements, follow these steps. There's the steps and additional information. The course will be held at the Shady Hook Fire Department address below 18 Riverside Road, Sandy Hook Court. This event is 37 miles from you. Whoever looked this up, that's how far it was from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. Contact Tom Romano. There's his email address, thomas.romano@ct.gov. Phone number 860-256-0844. And at the time, 19 of 30 seats are still available. Last day to register, 9/17/2010. So what are your thoughts about this sheep training course from the Department of Emergency Service and Public Protection? I think this is a little eerie to me that our federal government came in and taught these guys at Sandy Hook in Connecticut, that they taught them how to run drills. And to a lot of people, that's how this event seemed, is as if it was a drill. Anyway, I'll put the links at the bottom. You judge for yourself and tell me your opinion on this.
Horses run with a polished shield. Fight those bastards till they heal. Midnight man, blood red throne. Fight to keep this land your own. Sound the horn and call the cry. How many of them can we make die? Follow orders as you're told. Run cold, fight until you die or drop. A force like ours is hard to stop. Go
has come. Move your feet to a marching drum. We'll win the war and pay the toll. We'll fight as one in heart and soul. Midnight glare and blood red roan. Fight to keep this land your own. Sound the horn and call the cry. How many of them can we make die? Our axes flash, but also swing. Shining armor's piercing ring. Houses run with a polished shield. Fight those bastards till they yield.
Is change the way in which people think about guns, especially young people. One thing that I think is clear with young people and with adults as well is that we just have to be repetitive about this. It's not enough to simply have a catchy ad on a Monday and then only do it every Monday. We need to do this every day of the week and just really brainwash people 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 into thinking about guns in a vastly different way.
Hey guys, SGT here, and given the horrors that we saw occur at Sandy Hook Elementary on Friday, December 14th, and the many inconsistencies with the official story, I wanted to get our good friend, Mark S. Mann, that's his pseudonym, back on the line. Mark is a firearms industry executive, a part-time police officer, and he's sure to have interesting insight on what we saw happen last Friday. Mark, welcome back.
Hey, Sean, thanks for having me again.
Under these circumstances, Mark, it's not a pleasure to be talking about these things. It needs to be addressed. Anybody who's been following SGT Report knows that I think that the official story has big, giant holes in it, and we do not see the mainstream media addressing these holes. We do not see the mainstream Mockingbird media following up on reports of two people, men, in a van that were detained fleeing that school. They were detained by an officer. The raw police recordings reveal this as fact. We also know that another man was brought from the woods near the school wearing camo pants, and he was detained in the back of the police car, and we do not see anybody except for the alternative media following up on these very critical issues. Mark, what is your take on what you see happening? Because we also know they're now going to come after the guns, with this being the excuse.
Sean, the first thing I want to say is that this happened about 40 minutes away from where I live. I go by the pen name Mark S. Mann because I want to be considerate to my employer and the police agency that I work for, because some of the times I say things that they may or may not appreciate, and out of respect to anyone and for my own purposes, I don't use my real name. But one thing I do want to put out here, after writing several articles for you over the last year, is that I do live in Connecticut, and I'm about 40 minutes away from where this tragedy took place. And I know some of the first responders from the Connecticut State Police that were on scene. And the one thing that I think this incident has in common with a lot of the other incidents that have happened all the way back to 9/11 and a lot of the other mass shootings that have happened is there's always a flurry of media reports in the beginning, and there's always a lot of reported inconsistencies that even, you know, hours later or maybe days later don't add up. So I think it's a little interesting, going back to all the things that you pointed out, that things don't add up, okay? But rather than focus on those things, there are things that we know for a fact. And what my purpose in doing this interview with you is to get that stuff out into the public domain so people who are undecided about their stance on this stuff, people who are not sure where they may be as far as whether they're pro or anti-gun or whether they support this legislation, they can be up to speed with some facts that the mainstream media is ignoring, okay? And one of those facts is that I'm from the state of Connecticut. I grew up here, okay? I've been on the front lines of this fight with gun control in the state of Connecticut since I've been a young man. And the one thing that nobody's discussing is the fact that Connecticut already has an assault rifle bill. That bill went into effect in 1993 or 1994, and it never sunset when the federal assault weapons ban expired in 2004, 2005, okay? The Connecticut bill, which is still in place to this day, was even more strict than the 1994 crime bill. The only thing that we didn't have here that a lot of the other states had was a magazine capacity limit. We never had any restrictions on high cap magazines here, but all of our neighboring states, New Jersey, Massachusetts, New York, all those states had bills that were more strict than the original federal ban. They even named guns by type, so there wouldn't be loopholes in manufacturing to be able to get around some of the stuff that they didn't want people to have anymore. As a matter of fact, another not well-known fact of the Connecticut bill was the fact that we actually had a registration here. If you decided to keep any of the guns that were on their bad gun list, you had up until a certain date to register those guns, and you actually had to bring those guns to the state police barracks and get fingerprinted and basically tell them what you had. And that has never been repealed, okay? So the state of New Jersey is even worse. They had an even more strict ban with a 15-round mag capacity. And the reason why I bring this up is because the laws that are currently on the books here in Connecticut, New Jersey, New York, Massachusetts, in Maryland to some degree, all of those laws are more strict than the original crime bill, the assault rifle bill, okay? And that shows you that even though we have all these laws on the books, that it doesn't prevent crime. The assault weapons ban went away because after almost 10 years of collecting data, all the federal agencies and even the anti-gun groups were not able to show that there was a correlation between violent crime and the types of firearms that these laws were banning or prohibited from being manufactured or sold.
No, you're absolutely right, Mark. And there is a story out today that the English warn, quote, our gun ban caused a 40% jump in gun crime. Don't give up your guns. Now, we see Mayor Mike Bloomberg calling for a ban on assault weapons. We see Dianne Feinstein, the criminal Democrat from California, vowing to introduce an assault weapons ban bill. And she wants to ban the sale, the transfer, the importation, and possession of assault weapons. And you know what, Mark? I don't want to beat to death this idea that this was a black op false flag for the sole purpose of getting the sheeple American people behind the idea of a gun ban. Okay, we do not have to spend a lot of time on this call discussing that. But I do want to point out that one of the major inconsistencies in this story, as you well know, is that it was reported immediately on the first day, multiple times, over multiple venues, that the shooter, Adam Lanza, was found with two handguns.
Right. And the rifle was in the trunk of his car.
That's right. The assault rifle was in the trunk of his car. Later, to fit the official story and the coroner's report, it was then changed, and it was said that the assault rifle was found next to his body, and that three other guns, we don't know who those guns were registered to, were also found, and it was not disclosed as to where they were found. So as we see the man in the woods, arrested by police, and two other men fleeing in a van detained by police, why in God's name aren't there any cops in Connecticut coming forward to talk about what happened to those three men?
You know, it's funny you mention that, because I heard reports that there were over 1,200 police officers that responded to the scene, and I don't even know how that's responsible for local and state law enforcement to saturate an area like that. The way that they're responding to these situations is ridiculous. I'm not an expert on active shooter, although I do have a lot of experience in active shooter. I think one of the glaring inconsistencies that you talk about is the fact that you then have the state medical examiner going on to say that these poor victims were shot multiple times with a rifle. So how is it that they were shot multiple times with a rifle that was in the assailant's vehicle? Things don't add up. But the thing that you mentioned sheeple, and the one thing that really bothers me, Sean, is the fact that the people in this country, the sheeple in this country, are so far gone that they actually believe that somebody like President Obama can legislate these things from not happening anymore. That's an absolute joke, because murder is already against the law, okay? And you can't pass laws that would guarantee you from not having people committed to doing random acts of violence. That's not possible, no matter whether you take away people's guns or whatever you try and legislate. I think that's grossly negligent of him to lure people into a false sense of security.
No, you're absolutely right, Mark. I mean, we know by looking at Chicago, where there's a gun ban, and New York City, correct me if I'm wrong, where there's a gun ban, that oftentimes where there are gun bans, those are the areas of highest crime, because those are the areas where only the criminals have guns. Now, what the American sheeple seem unable to understand, those that are posting on Facebook that you should defriend me if you don't believe we should ban guns. My wife was seeing some of those this weekend. These people do not understand our Bill of Rights. They do not understand. They can't even tell you what the First Amendment is. They cannot tell you what the Second Amendment is, nor can they tell you why the founders gave us the Second Amendment and made it the Second Amendment. It is the last line of defense standing between a free people and a tyrannical government. And the fear...
It has nothing to do with hunting. It has nothing to do with hunting.
Absolutely not. And the fear that all of us who are awake have is this tyrannical government, which we have demonstrated it is prior to this, is now moving decisively against the Second Amendment and against that last line in the sand of our defense as a free people. Now, Stuart Rhodes of Oath Keepers is saying, quote, repealing the Second Amendment would start another civil war, end quote.
I'm glad you brought this up, because this is one question that I want to ask to the people out there, whether they're gun owners, whether they're hunters but own guns and don't consider themselves target shooters, whatever class of individual you fall into, whether you own guns or not. The question I have for people is this. We know that whatever laws that they pass will have no effect on the amount of violence that happens in our society with or without guns. As our society degenerates more and more, as the economy gets worse, as people get more desperate, we're going to see more and more acts of random violence, okay? And my question to people is, what is going to happen if they pass whatever laws that they want tomorrow or next week or next month in a year or two from now? We still have all of these incidents going on, and at that point, what are they going to tell you? That it didn't work, the laws didn't work, now we have to take your guns. That's what we're being set up for, and that's what people don't understand, okay? There's no way that these people can legislate any of these issues away. And the problem, Sean, that I see is that people do not want to look in the mirror. They do not want to accept personal responsibility. They do not want to look at the things that are plaguing our society, such as violence in Hollywood, violence on television, violence in video games, a general lack of parenting in this country. People do not want to look in the mirror at what is causing these issues in society. We do not have a problem with guns. We have a broken, morally bankrupt society that is as bankrupt morally as it is financially, and this is how it behaves. If you are a doctor, you do not treat a symptom. You treat a disease or a sickness.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head. We are now a society that is only capable of the easy answers, right? So if it's bailouts for banks to keep the economy going, no one questions it because nobody is intelligent enough to dig deeper and care. I mean, 5% of us are, but the majority of the public is completely dumbed down. They live on fast food, they live on bad television, and they believe everything the Mockingbird mainstream media tells them. And the problem with this particular scenario is that even if it wasn't a false flag, the powers that be are going to get exactly the reaction they want out of the sheeple, which is, oh, guns are a problem, let's ban guns. Because the people are so detached from the history of this country, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and the things that made us great, is they do not even understand how important it is that the people retain the right to bear arms. That's the sad truth. That's why we're completely screwed. And that's why Stuart Rhodes of Oath Keepers fears that this is going to lead to civil war, because there are a few, a growing number, of very concerned, very committed, very tuned in patriots that will not, and this comes according to Stuart Rhodes, turn their guns in no matter what the criminal government says.
I'm one of those people, I'm sure you are too, but there's two things that I want to address before we end this interview. And one of those things is, in addition to the things that we already pointed out, in addition to the problems that are creating the violence in our society, the violence in Hollywood, television, video games, just as a nation, we ingest and digest a tremendous amount of violence in our culture, and we've been desensitized to a tremendous amount of violence, especially at that young teen, preteen, early teen age, the video games, the whole nine yards, okay? And one of the things that contributes to all of those things is the media frenzy that envelops when any of these issues take place. And the reason why I think that's a problem is not just because of the unfair and lack of unbiased journalism, but when the media focuses on these shooters and splashes their pictures and their names all over the internet and the news, those people, whether they're alive or dead, they end up inspiring copycats. That's why when you see one of these incidents happen, there's always incidents that happen right after it, within hours or days of the incident that we're talking about. Because anybody that's on the edge of doing something like that says, well, you know, if that guy killed 20 people, I can kill 25. And look at what happened. This guy went up and shot a school, and he even got the President of the United States to stop in his tracks. And there's been psychologists and psychiatrists all over the world that see the approach that the media has with this stuff actually fans the flames of these incidents. The other thing that I think we need to talk about is the fact that, as, and I've said this before when you and I have talked, okay, we need, as gun owners, as patriots, as libertarians, as people who are concerned about our country and our fellow Americans, we need to start not worrying about what the powers that be are going to do, but what we are going to do in response. And I'm not being critical of the NRA, but they are the only voice, primarily, that gun owners have as a whole nationwide. There are a lot of state and local organizations, but the problem is that people are retreating. For an example, I was supposed to do a radio interview with a local station here. In light of the tragedy, they canceled it because they thought it would be in bad taste to discuss guns. I'm not saying that that was wrong and it was the right timing, but we can't back away from these people. These people are coming at us head on, and we cannot retreat from our stance on this issue. We must have a voice, and we must tell our elected officials that we will not tolerate any abuses to our Second Amendment rights.
Yeah, that's right. And none of us in this movement, not a patriot among us, would suggest a call to violence. None of us. All we want is peace, and all we want is to be left alone with our God-given rights. It is that when a tyrannical government moves against those rights, however, we do need to defend ourselves. And I know that's what you're saying, that's what Stuart Rhodes is saying, and that's what patriots all over this nation are saying. We can only pray that this government hears us. My fear is, they are hearing us, and they don't care.
No, they don't.
Mark, I can't thank you enough for your time. I mean, we could definitely talk about all of this for another half hour. Let's see how things transpire over the next couple of weeks, and then we'll probably need to get you back on for an update. Is there any website you want to direct people to that is important to you? I know that we use your pseudonym, so you can't give us much more than that. Any other information you want to leave us with?
Yeah, there's one thing that I would like to say, and this is for everybody that's out there on social media and people that discuss these things among their friends and family. The one thing that is absent from this entire discussion is that the media never mentions anything about the fact that firearms are used hundreds of times a day, where the mere presence of a firearm either thwarts a crime or a violent act. And people say, well, why don't you ever hear about it? Well, no body count equals no headline. The media doesn't care, and it's against their agenda to report where it's proper use of a firearm and legal use of a firearm actually does something good. That goes against their agenda and against their mission. We need to realize that firearms do provide value in our society, and probably the only reason why things aren't worse than they already are in this country is because there are people out there who are legally armed and believe in the things that we're talking about.
Yeah, and you're absolutely right. The mainstream media does have an agenda. That is why over the years so many people would say to me, friends, family, coworkers, if the 9/11 thing that you've spoken about truly was a false flag, if the official story wasn't true, wouldn't the mainstream media seize on that? Because certainly young reporters would want to make a name for themselves. No. They cannot, they do not, they only toe the line. That's what they get paid for. And if you step out of line, you lose your job. We've seen it at CNN, we've seen it at Fox News, we've seen it all over the place. And I'm going to give the name of one real reporter doing real work who is not bought and paid for, and his name is Ben Swan. So I look forward to Ben Swan's report about what we saw happen at Sandy Hook Elementary, because there is more to the story. And I know that since Ben Swan isn't a CFR member like so many of these other hoaxers that give us our news are, we should get some truth out of Ben Swan and some real reporting. Mark, again, thanks.
He's excellent.
Yeah, he's great. Mark, again, thanks for your time. We can't thank you enough for your time. We really appreciate it, and let's stay in touch.
Okay, Sean, take care of yourself.
Okay, Mark. Thanks, man. Bye.
Well, guys, that'll do it. Thanks so much for tuning in. I really can't thank you enough. Please tune in to sgtreport.com for the very latest in alternative news every day. And check out thelibertymill.com. Real news, 24/7. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Hi guys, this is the Idaho Picker, and I'm bringing you a video today that I wish I had nothing to do with, because it's sick. I'm going to take you through some information, and I don't have it all nailed down, figured out. I'm going to show you a number of inconsistencies, a couple of smoking guns, a couple of tie-ins, some things that should shake your soul, because it does mine. With that being said, let's see if I can get through this. Hey, this is the father of the person that is alleged to have killed these children. He is a I'll show you. He works. He's a high-end accountant. Okay, he works for GE. Yeah, the big GE, the big powerful GE owned by trying to choose the right words to say in this video so that everybody could watch this. And it's very difficult. So let me just say he works at GE Capital. He's also a partner at Ernst & Young. Both of these organizations are ran by the same people who I've been ranting about for a long time now. He also is rumored, I can't confirm this yet, he also is rumored to be a member of the CIA. Of course, we all know who those guys are. If anybody can get any factual verification on that, let me know. I also have a message in to my Mr. X CIA insider that is going to try to verify that for me. Let's keep moving here. I got a lot of stuff to show you. Of course, this is Ryan Lanza that they first initially said had done this. And this is his Facebook page, which yesterday was locked down and would not come up yesterday afternoon. Today it's back up, but it has basically nothing showing on it, or very little. It has a couple things, but there is way less than was showing yesterday. However, there were a few people who got a few screenshots of him posting, saying that it was not him that did it. And of course, then we all found out that supposedly his younger brother had stolen his ID, supposedly, and had it in his pocket. And he was the one that was found in the classroom, in the school, dead, that they reported. And you can see just by Adam's Facebook page that, assuming that Adam put this information in there, that in fact Adam may have had some problems, and other problems we've heard of. I've done a ton of research here, guys. Everything I know, I'm not saying to you. Now, the mother is supposedly a teacher at the school. This is the school's website. Okay. This is where you can pull up and see who the teachers are at a school. The mother is not a teacher at the school. That is all of the Sandy Hook school teachers and administrators' information all right there. I'll be putting the link below. Says that the gunman was wearing dark clothing, a mask, a bulletproof vest, and was carrying four guns. Okay. We all know the story that they've been feeding us. I'm going to take you, let you watch a little video here. And then I've got numerous other things that are going to be highly shocking for you to see. Let's keep going here. Actually, before I do this, I'm going to tell you this. The father, okay, he is scheduled to testify in the LIBOR scandal. This man here. Guess who else is scheduled to testify? The father of John Holmes. Or James Holmes, excuse me, James Holmes. The Batman Massacre, Aurora, Colorado, they're both scheduled to testify for the LIBOR scandal. Does that not give you chills? Okay, let's continue on. Okay, let's see if I can make this video play without crashing everything.
It's believed at this hour, and it's been confirmed to ABC News by state police there in Connecticut, that two shooters were initially believed involved in the mass shooting. One of those shooters, now dead. What's not been confirmed is whether or not that gunman took his own life.
So you heard that little report there saying two shooters, right? Well, now they're saying it was just one shooter. They're sticking with the one shooter story, okay? Let's go find out how many shooters there were. Let's look into that a lot further here in just a moment. Okay. Now here is a video that we're going to watch of the police chasing someone that they've seen go into the woods. Now remember, the 20-year-old is dead in the classroom. They're going to go chase somebody through the woods, and then they're going to have him on the ground. You can see it through the trees just enough to see they're standing around and have this man on the ground. Okay. They also, and I will show you in this video, you will hear it from the police themselves, say that they have somebody on the ground just outside the school, prone. They have him proned out outside the school with the south. It was at the southeast corner of the school. But let's watch this first. Sorry about the dog barking, guys. I've got the audio turned off on this. I have listened to the audio numerous times over and over, and there's a lot of squealing and stuff, but there's nothing there that's usable. I've heard the words that they've said. I see him running up into the trees. Okay, they're going out there because they know there was two people that were outside the building. I will prove that as well. Two shooters outside, as well as the young man that was dead inside that they claimed as the shooter. One they chased up in the woods up here and caught him. The other one they caught just outside the school and had him proned out on the ground. I will demonstrate that to you here in just a minute. And here in just a moment, I'm going to stop it. See him standing around under that tree? Okay. I'll put the link below so you can watch this video again. There is a guy laying on the ground right here, face down, with his hands behind his back. There's someone laying on the ground. There's multiple police officers standing right around here. See him on the ground? See all the police officers standing around? Out in the woods. Why would they be standing around out there with someone laying on the ground if that wasn't a perpetrator? So there you have shooter number one. We're going to get into shooter number two in a minute. That would be shooter number two already, and we're going to talk about shooter number three in a minute. And we'll also talk about two and three again.
And so the teachers, we hear like lots of bangs, and we thought that it was the custodian knocking stuff down. We heard screaming, and then a police came in. It's like, is he in here? And he ran out. And then our teacher, then somebody yelled, get to a safe place. So we went to the closet in the gym. And we sat there for a little while, and then the police, like, were knocking on the door, and they're like, we're evacuating people. So we ran out. There's police about at every door. They're leading us down this way, quick, come on. And we ran down to the firehouse. There's a man pinned down to the ground with handcuffs on.
Did you hear that? There was a man pinned down to the ground with handcuffs on. Perpetrator number two, or shall we say number three. There's one in the woods. There's one right outside the school on the ground. This little boy said he has no reason to lie. And I have the police audio stating they had him proned out on the ground. There was one in the woods that ran into the woods that was with the one they had proned out. You'll hear the officer say, they are coming. They're coming my way. And he took one of them down. The other one ran into the woods. We got three shooters. Or really more likely, we have two shooters. And we have a sacrificed boy of 20 years old.
And we thought that was the victim. We really didn't get a good glance at him because he was, like, there's a car blocking it. Plus, we were running really quick.
So there you have, you got a guy in the classroom dead. You got a guy outside the building on the ground. And you got the cops with one up in the trees. Okay. Random page there that I forgot to close, guys, when I was researching stuff. Now let's take a look at, listen to some audio here. I've got several audio clips I want to play for you. This is at 129 on this video. I'll put the link below. Okay, let's listen to that again.
Be aware that we could have a second unit.
Come back. We'll play again in a second.
Sorry, Dan, you're talking to me. Acknowledge, we don't have any additional crew
here comes
on station.
I don't find out. Party on the I got him prone out.
I've got the party on, and I got him proned out. That's what he said. One more time.
Acknowledge. We don't have any additional crew on station.
I don't find out. Party on the I got him proned out.
Got him proned out.
For that unit, be aware that we could have a second unit.
Okay, let's go ahead and move on to the second clip. So that is actual audio recording of the event taking place and the police saying they had him proned out.
I know there's not a parent in America who doesn't feel the same overwhelming grief that I do. The majority of those who died today were children. Beautiful little kids between the ages of 5 and 10 years old.
Okay.
They had their entire lives ahead of them. Birthdays, graduations, weddings.
Lost a child yesterday.
Kids of their own.
Hook Elementary School shootings here in Connecticut. Okay. So my name is Robbie Parker. My family is one of the families that lost a child yesterday in the Sandy Hook Elementary School shootings here in Connecticut. Things go out to so many people. As the deep pain begins to settle into our hearts, as the deep pain begins to settle into our hearts, as the deep pain begins to settle into our hearts, as the deep pain begins to settle into our hearts, we find comfort reflecting on the incredible person that Emily was and how many lives that she was able to touch in her short time here on Earth. Emily was bright, creative, and very loving. Emily was always willing to try new things, other than food. She loved to use her talents to touch the lives of everyone that she came into contact with. She was an exceptional artist, and she always carried around her markers and pencils so that she never missed an opportunity to draw a picture or make a card for those around her. I can't count the number of times Emily noticed someone feeling sad or frustrated and would rush to find a piece of paper to draw them a picture or to write them an encouraging note.
The best way that I've been seeing that is I have two really good friends at home who have set up a Facebook page to help raise money for Emily. To help raise money for Emily. And
some you can't disguise. Twist of truth and half the news. Can't hide it in your eyes.
Start looking around. It's all witchcraft. You're giving the demons and the devils your emotional energy. When you don't give it to them. In the real world, they're just looking to screw you over in man's law. But in the spiritual world, they're thriving on your energy. And they're lying to you. God bless.
Last week, Aaron Dykes covered how the UN has been incrementally trying to dig into our Second Amendment. Well, guess what? It's hitting home now because we just released a story today titled UN Gun Grab Follows State Department Plan. This is going to get scary. The UN arms trade treaty that has been identified by observers as a flagrant threat to the Second Amendment, in which Barack Obama is determined to sign, has its roots in a 1961, you hear that, 1961 State Department memorandum, which explains how the United Nations will oversee complete disarmament of all the people under the ruse of preventing war. Are you hearing me? That's what they're talking about. They're going to take your guns under the ruse of preventing war. Let's go to that document. We'll come back to this in 1 second. Here's the document. It's entitled Freedom from War, State Department Publication 7277, released September 1961. Okay? September 1961 is when they started writing this. And you know what it says here? The United States Program for General and Complete Disarmament and a Peaceful World. Yeah, the only ones that are going to have guns are the United Nations soldiers. And guess what? There's not going to be any peace with them. They're going to be kicking your heads in and shooting everybody in sight. And they've already done it. It's happened time and time again. You can look at Africa. You can look in East Asia. That's what they plan on doing. That's their version of peacekeeping. We're going to go into this document right now. In the Office of Public Services, Bureau of Public Affairs. It only cost 15 cents. It was interesting. In 1961. So in their introduction, they talk about a program for general and complete disarmament in a peaceful world. Okay, make no mistake about it. This isn't just hidden one time in this document. We're going to go through it all. They talk about freedom from war and security for all states. And what does security for the state mean? That means no security for the individual. That means you don't have any rights. It's only the state that's going to have rights. First, there must be immediate disarmament action. And this is written by our State Department. A goal of general and complete disarmament. Second, all disarmament obligations must be subject to effective international controls. You know what that means? No Second Amendment. They talk about the stages of the disarmament process. Third, adequate peacekeeping machinery must be established. Nations are unlikely to shed their means of self-protection in the absence of alternative ways to safeguard their legitimate interests, like freedom from tyranny. This can only be achieved through progressive strengthening of international institutions under the United Nations and by creating United Nations Peace Force to enforce the peace as the disarmament process proceeds. You guys, you better get serious. You better start talking to people. You better start warning people because it's going to start happening soon. We know they're already training to do this. We've already been telling you this for years, okay? And here it is from 1961, and it's been incrementally happening. Let's go back to the document. Disarmament goals and objectives. Preserve internal order and contributions to a United Nations peace force. So that's taxes that they're going to use from us to go back and take your guns later through the United Nations, through the blue hats. Establishment and effective operation of an internal disarmament organization within the framework of the United Nations to ensure compliance at all times with all disarmament obligations. Okay? Governing principles. We're going to move down here. Inspection and verification must establish both that nations carry out scheduled limitations or reductions and that they do not retain armed forces and armaments in excess of those permitted at any stage of the disarmament process. There it is, right there, in the document. Here we go on page 4. Arms and armed forces would be reduced. The armed forces of the United States and the Soviet Union would be limited to 2.1 million men each, with appropriate levels not exceeding the amount for other militarily significant states. Levels of armaments would be correspondingly reduced, and their production would be limited. This is all by a world body. This is not going to be through anything through our country. This is through the United Nations, which means there's no negotiations. There's only killing people and machine gunning them when they don't comply. States would be committed to other measures to reduce international tension. and to protect the chance of war by accident, miscalculation, or surprise attack. And they go through a second stage and a third stage. Here we go in the third stage. The manufacture of armaments would be prohibited except for those agreed types and quantities to be used by the UN Peace Force and those required to maintain internal order. All other armaments would be destroyed or converted to peaceful purposes. This all sounds beautiful and glowing in your new world order, but you know what it's going to be? It's going to be used to come in and take your wealth, take your property, take everything you have. And they're going to start by taking your guns. Here we go to the Declaration on Disarmament. The United States program. Let's get a shot of this. People aren't going to believe it till they see it. Here it is right here. This is their appendix. A Declaration on Disarmament. The United States program for general and complete disarmament in a peaceful world. The nations of the world, conscious of the crisis in human history produced by a revolutionary development of modern weapons within a world divided by serious ideological differences. That means those who are for freedom and those who want to take everything from you and live lavish while you live as a slave. Determined to save present and succeeding generations from the scourge of war and the dangers and burdens of the arms race, and to create conditions in which all people can strive freely and peacefully to fulfill their basic aspirations as long as they kneel to the New World Order, declare their goal to be a free, secure, and peaceful world of independent states. That it will not happen. It will be no independent states. Adhering to the common standards of justice and international conduct and subjecting the use of force to the rule of law. A world where adjustment to change takes place in accordance with the principle of the United Nations, which means nobody has guns and everybody listens to the United Nations. A world where we shall be a permanent state of general and complete disarmament under effective international control, and where the resources of nations shall be devoted to man's material, cultural, and spiritual advance, set forth as the objectives under a program of general and complete disarmament in a peaceful world. So what does all that mean? Well, that means they're going to take your guns, and once they take your guns, you're not going to have any type of freedom of speech. You're not going to have any type of freedom of the press. You're not going to have anything. And we already reported on this before. I want to go back to the UN gun grab follows State Department plan. This came out today from Paul Joseph Watson, dated Monday, July 16th, 2012. There's the article. You can go read it all on Infowars.com. They link to a Forbes article under here. It's the UN Arms Treaty has caused so much controversy because it outlines a plan to target all types of conventional weapons, notably small arms and light weapons, according to Forbes' Larry Bell. There's the Forbes article. So even Forbes is saying they're coming after your Second Amendment. All right. And Forbes isn't known for protecting the Second Amendment at all. They also have a quote from U.S. Ambassador to the UN, John Bolton, who said probably the first intelligent thing I've ever heard him say. He also warns that the agreement is trying to act as though it is really just a treaty about international arms trade between nation states, but there is no doubt that the real agenda here is domestic firearms control. Okay? They're talking about your small guns. They're talking about the guns that can be used in a guerrilla war against the United Nations when they come to invade and send troops from other countries here to take your guns. That's what it's talking about. But you know what? You don't believe me, do you? You're still in denial, aren't you? Those who are out there in denial. Well, let's go to a clip. It's going to start off with the New Orleans chief of police during Katrina saying, no one will be allowed to have guns, all weapons will be taken. And then it's going to go to today's show where Mike Adams got a call from someone who was actually in Katrina with the 45th Infantry Brigade. I'm sorry I'm flustered because this information is really disturbing me right now. He was there confiscating guns. They were going door to door. They were kicking in as they asked, do you need any assistance? Boom. Do you have any guns? We're taking them.
You said guns will be taken. No one will be able to be armed. We will take all weapons.
Today in New Orleans, they got a lot tougher on the holdouts.
Police department at your home!
Not only the flooded areas, but New Orleans' driest and wealthiest neighborhoods, too.
Police department!
The police and National Guard going street by street, house to house, sometimes entering open houses with guns drawn, and instructions to disarm anyone inside.
Let's go to Chris in Oklahoma. Chris, you're on the air on the Alex Jones Show. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, Hells Ranger. How's it been?
Good. It's good here, man. How about yourself?
Oh, pretty good, pretty good. I was with the 45th Infantry Brigade and Delta Company 1st of the 279, 2nd Platoon. During Hurricane Katrina, I'm kind of calling in on yesterday's subject. I'm sorry about that.
It's all right.
But, I've always wanted to get a hold of you guys and kind of get the word out there for those that still have that slight hesitation in the back of their head that gun confiscation can't and won't happen here. It already has. And I was only 21 years old, just really gung-ho, really dedicated to the Army, especially to the infantry. And I did whatever I was told. And
what did they ask you to do?
The first thing we did was we got a 3-week full of 3-week-old 911 phone calls, right? And then we had to go around and answering all the phone calls. So we were like cadaver dogs for about 3 weeks. And in between them, we would run night missions. And here's the thing. A lot of people may think that they'll see this on the news or they'll have time to get ready when the crap hits the fan or whatever. It's just, it's a truck. You know what I mean? It's a group of trucks. They pull up, they stack right on your home, as we did, and we broke entry. Yeah, we would yell out, Oklahoma Army National Guard, is anybody in need of assistance? But that's as we were booting in the door.
But wait a minute. It sounds like you weren't part of the Oklahoma National Guard. I mean, you were U.S. military.
Yeah, I was activated. I think about a week after Katrina, I was watching it on the news, and Sher Kamiko of Fox 23 told me before my unit even got a hold of me that I was going to New Orleans.
So we got
sent in, and we were the very very first boots on the ground, Alpha Company.
And you were confiscating firearms.
Left and right, yes. And we were also monitoring the New Orleans police because we kept having, like, you know, like the first day we had this little beautiful redheaded lady come up.
All right, wait a minute. We're almost out of time. Will you stay on the line for us, please? I want to continue with you on the other side. Stay on the line with us. This is fascinating. We're going to continue this right here on the Alex Jones Show. We'll be right back.
That happened today in this wealthy neighborhood where homeowners had armed themselves to protect their mansions. Residents were handcuffed on the ground. In the end, police took their weapons but let them stay in their homes.
They were a little bit threatened because our weapons were bigger than their weapons.
Chris Montgomery says he'd rather be in Iraq than patrolling American neighborhoods.
Walking up and down these streets, you don't want to think about the stuff that you're going to have to do if somebody pops around the corner.
Let me shoot an American.
Yeah.
We have Chris on the line from Oklahoma relating a story about gun confiscation in New Orleans and that entire region following Hurricane Katrina several years ago. And Chris, go ahead. You were saying, you were describing how you and your team were kicking in doors and confiscating firearms from people. Did anybody resist? Did anybody ever shoot back? What happened?
Well, we had a couple of people resist verbally, and they got stuffed and cuffed very violently. We throw them in the back of the 5-ton or the deuce and a half or whatever, and then we take them out to the Greyhound bus station, which was the police station at the time. Before we came up, or before the break, I think it was like the second day we were there, this redheaded lady came up to our platoon's area, and she sat, or to our company area, she sat on the curb with her knees in her chest, just rocking back and forth, crying uncontrollably. She sat there for almost 27 hours, just refused to move. We talked to her, we did everything we could, just didn't want to, you know. You could tell she had been through enough. She'd been repeatedly raped by men in NOPD masks and NOPD uniforms.
Oh, you're kidding me.
So we were told, you know, at that point we were told the NOPD obviously isn't our friend. We need to start watching them. The FBI had us out there at Cooter Brown, which is the NOPD Sheriff's Brother's Bar. It's like the big cop bar there in New Orleans.
Just so people know, NOPD is New Orleans Police Department, just for people who know.
Yeah, definitely. Not the police department.
So a lot of those cops were then just total rogue. I mean, we saw a video of some of them going in and looting retail stores and things like that, but they were raping women down there?
Definitely raping women. They were. We got two separate women that came to our company alone. And when I was there, I met cats from the California Guard, Indiana Guard, you name it. Everybody was there.
But how?
It was just a free for all. Police from all over the country, Dallas County, Dallas, Texas sheriffs down there.
But how did you and your team justify to yourselves and each other that gun confiscation would help this situation when it was a free for all? I mean, isn't that a time when citizens need to be able to defend themselves?
It never, you know, like I said, I was just ignorant as hell. And that's kind of something that I worry about with the kids today, you know, if they really realize what they're doing. You know, I had no idea. The only time it ever occurred to me that something may be wrong is we came up, we were down by the old French district. We came up to this man's house. He had a big wooden sign that says, "I'm here alone with my dog and my shotgun. Looters beware." We thought, you know, it's funny. Everyone stopped, took pictures of the sign. But eventually we took his guns. And we left him there with nothing.
So now that you know what you know, now that you're listening to the Alex Jones Show and you're informed, what would you advise people to do if this happens again?
Well, I called. I mean, no offense. I mean, Mike, we would love everything you do. Big fan of the Health Ranger. But I was hoping to get a hold of Alex for the fact that, what do you do when they stack right? You know what I mean?
And
they're prepped to come into the home. There's no negotiating with us, trust me. There was no negotiating.
Yeah.
If you resisted, you died. That were the orders. You go for gunner, you die.
Yeah, but well, I mean, this is invaluable information. I apologize. We only have a limited time here. I got to let you go. Just we've got so much more coming up here, but fascinating. I hope you call back and get to Alex as well. You know, I'll pass on this conversation to Alex and let him know. But that's some frightening information, and it's. I just hope that the military, the members of the military say no. They refuse to engage in gun confiscation because no doubt there could be outbreaks of violence and a lot of needless death and bloodshed if that happens. But thank you for your call, Chris. That's very concerning.
It was traumatic. All of a sudden, they were banging in the front door, the side door, and the back door, and they said, "Let us in." I'm saying, "Look at all my food. I got plenty of food." They kept pushing me back, and ended up like this.
Then, Patty showed them a small revolver she was carefully holding in the palm of her hand. A camera crew was there to capture what unfolded next.
I said, "It's not even loaded," and I dropped it on the floor.
You got a gun.
Well, they punched me in the face. Look at my black and blue marks. Look at.
You said guns will be taken.
No one will be able to be armed. We will take all weapons.
So if you're still doubting, there's the proof there. They went into New Orleans. They went into the high and dry areas. They went in just to grab guns because that's what they were training to do. It wasn't about helping people. It was about taking people's guns to see if they could get away with it under a crisis. And that's how it's going to happen. It's going to happen in the dead of night. Did you hear the soldier talking? He said, "We pulled up at night and we just busted in and grabbed guns." That's how they do it. They're not going to be, "Hey, please turn in your guns." No, it's going to be right down to the wire, and you're not even going to know that they're going to be there until they're on top of you while you're sleeping in your bed. So you better start making a plan. You better start having firearms. You better start learning how to shoot. You better start getting ammo. Because if you don't exercise the Second Amendment, it will be taken from you. And when the Second Amendment goes, it's you in tyranny. It's boots on your forehead. It's slave internment camps. And it's all going to happen. They've all been making plans. Remember in early July 6th? We had the article by Paul Joseph Watson. Army manual outlines plans to kill rioters and demonstrators in America. Newly leaked U.S. Army military police training manual for civil disturbance operations, that means here in the United States, outlines how military assets will be used domestically to quell riots, confiscate firearms, and even kill Americans on soil during mass civil unrest. Warning shots will not be fired. And that he linked to a Hong Kong document, and we can go to that, and it shows you some of the things they're going to use. Oh, there's the grenade launchers they're going to use against you. There's the little round that they're going to put in there as they shoot at you. Okay? That's what it's all about. It's all about you. It's all about them creating the crisis. And then they come at you and take your guns because the crisis has been created. It's unfolding right now. Okay? The economy is going down the tubes. Everywhere in Austin, they have these free or so-called free money title loans things where they give you free money or so-called, but then they come and take your property. Those only happen when there's a bad economy, when people don't have jobs, and they're springing up everywhere like weeds, okay? And they're brand new and they're painted and they just, boom, they pop up. There's five of them right around my house. And I live in a pretty decent area of town, but it just says everybody's hurting. And when people start hurting, people start doing crazy things. Just like Gerald Celente says, when they lose everything, they lose it. And that's going to be the pretext to come in and start taking people's guns, and the Army's going to be kicking in doors, and they're training the National Guard to do it, and they're training the military police to do it, and they're training your SWAT teams, and they're giving them giant battle tanks to do it. It's all coming down. One more article I want to get to. Army Corps trained soldiers to confiscate constitutionally protected firearms. That was from Kurt Nemo the same day we released the other one. Right, and we got that from the guys over at Hong Kong. Dan Feit sent that to us. And in addition to revealing how federal government and Pentagon will respond to civil disturbances in violation of the 1878 Posse Comitatus Act, the United States Military Police Schools Civil Disturbance Operations document instructs how military will confiscate Americans' weapons from American citizens. I'm sorry, I'm not reading everything eloquent right off a teleprompter, but I'm scared. This is scary information. You need to get this out to everybody you know right now. It's all there. You could go check out the headline. We gave you the headlines. Go read the articles. Go to the links. Go read this document right here. Here it is. It says it in plain English. The United States Program for General and Complete Disarmament in a Peaceful World. It's all right there. You better get this information out. Don't waste any more time. You better get some guns. You better get a plan. You better learn how to shoot. Don't waste this time now that we have, because it is precious and the time is running short.
A couple days ago, I was searching for images for Stuart Rhodes when I stumbled upon a person named Jennifer Sexton. She was tied to him through some photographs that I found online, and basically when I went to her Google profile, I found her Picasa web album. So in her Picasa web album, you can see her photos, and in her photos you can go through all these that you want. I'm going to start with, say, this one right here. Some individuals in here that you know. This right here is the person that we've been told is Christina Taylor Greene. And notice the dates. This is her sister. On to some other photographs. This one from January 16th, this album. This is her brother. Her sister again. Cousin. All of them together in Florida. The reason why I'm showing you this is you're going to find out who they really are in a moment. Again, these aren't password protected. These aren't hacked or any way. These are just out there and for public view. This is their mother put them out there, Jennifer Sexton. And you'll notice that Jennifer Sexton, her mother, means that I don't believe Christina Green is her name. And you'll see why in a moment. All right, let's go to the Passover photographs. You'll notice there are some captions underneath the some of the photographs where we can see their names and see who they actually are. And there's a few in here that are very important, and I'll go over those in a second. As we can see the caption here, sisters. There's her father. Her father's name is Richard. That's their mother. That's Sexton. Jennifer Sexton. Jonathan, Brett, and Emily. That's the one. Richard. That's their uncle. That's the mother and father, Jennifer and Rich. This individual here is her mother, so that's Christina's grandmother. Now I want you to take a close look at that face. That's Katie Callen. And I'll do a side-by-side comparison for you to be able to tell, but you'll see. Now, this one is the great-grandmother. You know her also. One of the victims of the Giffords shooting. Now also, there's Grandmom. Now this one right here, oops, her husband is particular because you'll see in a moment who he is. Him right here, Robert. Robert is the one that was on the news saying that he was the father of another victim of the Gabrielle Giffords shooting, Gabe Zimmerman. Now you'll notice Jennifer Sexton's stop at August 29th, 2010, before the alleged Gabrielle Giffords shooting. Now, of course, one would say, well, that's why, because she was shot. I'll show you in a moment that the truth about that. Here's another individual I want you to pay close attention to, because we're gonna two individuals that we're going to talk about, and right here is one of them. That's Dallas Green. That's his wife, Vicky. Vicky's last name and Dallas's last name are actually Greenberg. Dallas's first name isn't actually Dallas, it's Michael. So it's Michael Greenberg and Vicky Greenberg. They are the grandparents of Samantha Sexton and her sister and brother, and those are her cousins. And let's go to Samantha's birthday, so you know I'm not making this up. And this is her 12th birthday party. And there you go, Samantha's 12th birthday party. Samantha Sexton. Not Christina and Christina Taylor Green. The other interesting thing is how open they were about putting their Halloween stuff up here and then leaving an address of where they live. Again, this isn't password protected. I'm not stealing anything. I'm not showing you anything that's not for public on the web. You can zoom in here and you can basically go to the Google Maps and you can pull up exactly their street address. I mean, it's I don't understand why they're doing this, but they did. Fortunately for us, they did, because it shows the truth about an event that hijacked this nation. And it shows exactly who is behind this thing and their ties. So now let's go back to Jennifer Sexton's main page. And we see Vicky Greenberg. Vicky Greenberg, again, is the wife of Dallas Greenberg, or actually Dallas Michael Greenberg, the Philadelphia baseball pitcher. And if we look at Vicky's photos, we're going to see some very interesting things here. Now, you notice that the shooting, the alleged shooting, which it's proved to be an event that was planned by Homeland Security called an X-Plan, and you can see the presentation I do on WellAware1.com where I can prove that with their documents and with one photograph. Now, this proves it again, and this is something that proves the entire thing is a lie. That event was supposed to supposedly took place on January 8th, 2011. Well, of course, then anything after January 8th, 2011 wouldn't have Christina Green in it, correct? Because she was allegedly shot and killed. Well, here's the truth about that. March 28th, 2011. This is Tanner's bar mitzvah. We can go and we can see the people that attended that bar mitzvah. And there is mother, daughter, and daughter. Christina Ann Green and her sister. Samantha Sexton and her sister. There's more photographs of them at the event as well, so you know I'm just not making these up. There you go. She's grown up a little bit. She looks rather different, but that's her nevertheless. There's Dallas, or Michael Greenberg. Dallas Green, Philadelphia Phillies. His wife, Vicky. Grandmother and grandfather. And these are all the rest of the little kids that are there. And so you can see that this is a full-on album with everybody in there. There's the, you can even read the date on the program. Matches the date when the photographs were taken. And you can go through these, like I said, in detail and see everybody involved. Now, this right here proves 100% that the Giffords event was a drill. It proves that Christina Ann Green does not exist, and this is the person that is still alive past the date of the alleged shooting. You can also see that this person is Dallas Green's granddaughter. You'll see many more pictures in here. I mean, it's the whole album is just, it's full of photographs of the grandparents and their grandchildren. And of course, you see who the real mother and father are of those two individuals. Now, the other thing I want you to remember is these individuals have close ties to West Palm, Florida. And the other event that was big news close by there, which was in the Orlando area, was the Casey Anthony trial. Remember the little baby from the Casey Anthony trial? This one? Well, as you might guess, the individuals that faked this whole Gabrielle Giffords shooting and all this other crap have a lot of ties in the entertainment industry and have a lot of control over what you see on the TV. They also play big roles in these events. Look familiar? That's her sister. Child, look familiar? She should. That is the baby that was killed in the Casey Anthony trial. Again, you see the lies that these people are perpetrating on this country. This is also one of Dallas Green's granddaughters. Dallas Green seems to have his hands in a lot of events going on here. Dallas seems to have very close ties, and here's Dallas here, by the way. Michael Greenberg. He has very close ties to Canadian connections, which I've been saying all along seems to be a large number of operatives come out of that area. Now, how long has Mr. Dallas Green been an operative? I don't know. I have no idea. But you can obviously tell through his connections that he has a lot of people in his family that are playing these games on the rest of this country. So, I just wanted to share this with you. Again, I'll put the URLs to these entire albums in the description, and I'll put them in the video So you'll be able to see for yourself what I'm talking about, and you'll see that these are very extensive photo albums put together. They are way too extensive to be faked. They document this family's entire life, basically. Well, since really 2006, which I said most of the media lies were starting in around 2007. So I could have been wrong with that, because I'm thinking that these people really started this whole thing up in around 2006, and it ramped it up to recent days. They have a lot of ties to Israel. You'll see all their a lot of photographs where the families have gone to Israel and to India and things like that, but Canada as well, some Switzerland and stuff, but mainly Israel seems to be one of their main places since they are Jewish. So I wanted to bring this to you and let you guys look at it and see for yourself that the Gabriel Giffords event is a lie. Gabriel Giffords is a lie. Christine Ann Green is a lie. All those individuals are a lie. Everyone is a lie.
Attention all Americans, we are anonymous. In early December of 2012, a crazy person in Connecticut went to a school and killed 20 school children and a number of adults. The attack in a theater in Colorado was the act of a crazy person. There are always some crazy people, and there are already laws in place making it illegal for them to attain or to use them. It is illegal to take a firearm into a school or a theater. It is illegal to kill people. Yet these laws did not stop these events, because criminals do not obey the law. Only law-abiding citizens obey the law, and the law-abiding citizens are not the problem. Connecticut is the fourth highest gun control state in the country, and it's very hard to get a gun. Chicago and New York have the highest crime rates, and each has had total gun bans for years, yet gun violence increased. Mexico has a total gun ban for all citizens, but in the last 3 years, more than 55,000 people have been killed by guns, because only the drug cartels and criminal government have them. Throughout history, authoritarian governments have used gun violence as an excuse to take people's firearms and control their population. This is exactly what Adolf Hitler did to disarm the German people, and look at the atrocities his administration did. Obama has been working hard to try and ban all semi-automatic weapons and shotguns, while at the same time, increasing the weapons and firepower that police and government agencies have. Within minutes of the Connecticut shootings, politicians were on the state-run media saying it was time to get rid of the guns, and they will be talking about it for weeks to come. The Obama administration and his government-funded media have been promoting this idea for months. Every time there is a shooting performed by a crazy person, the media talks about it non-stop for weeks or months. But when there is an illegal or unlawful shooting by police that does not fit Obama's agenda, the story is barely mentioned, such as some of the following cases.
August 2, 2012. Chavis Carter was shot in the head while handcuffed in a patrol car in police custody. Police claim he hid the gun and shot himself, even though he already told his girlfriend they would go to a movie when he got out. January 2009. BOP police officer Johannes Messel shoots and kills a handcuffed, restrained, unarmed man, while multiple other police officers are around. August 2012. A man at the Empire State Building has killed a co-worker, and the police showed up and unleashed a hail of gunfire at the man, killing him, and the police bullets also injured many pedestrians. July 2012. Some protesters demand answers from police about why they shot a man in the back. The police responded on the crowd of protesters that had many children under the age of 10 with rubber bullets and attack dogs.
These stories got barely a whimper out of the press, and certainly did not get the coverage of several weeks, even though they are just as newsworthy. In addition, are the other major violent crimes where firearms were not even used.
August 2007, Connecticut. In a home invasion, a wife and two children were murdered. The wife and youngest daughter were also victims of sexual assault. Only the father-husband survived, and he was badly beaten. October 2012. A mother and her two children were brutally murdered in California home. The suspect did not use a firearm. October 2012. Two children were found stabbed to death when their mother returned home. The suspect was the children's nanny. September 2012. Siblings' throat slit by intruder.
The press also hardly mentions the cases where guns were used by law-abiding citizens to save lives to avoid being raped or killed.
October 2012. 12-year-old Oklahoma girl shoots home intruder to protect herself after she tried to evade them. January 2012. 14-year-old boy kills intruder when a gang of four men break into his house, where he was alone with his 17-year-old sister. Many would have you believe that guns are the cause of violence, but that is like saying fat people are obese because they have forks and spoons. It is caused by the person that commits the acts, not the instrument they used. If guns were the cause of the violence, then the police would be committing more violence with guns and would need disarmed instead of being more heavily armed. And the military and National Guard should never be used to perform law enforcement duties. Other Anons and many other people, including Alex Jones and many others, have provided lots of evidence over the years to these facts. It has been known, predicted by many for several months, and in some cases years, that Mr. Obama's intentions are to confiscate all firearms, or at least as much as he can, to make it easier to usher in a fascist police state, to establish a one-world government, and under a one-world currency system. It was a tragedy in Connecticut, where the school children were murdered by a crazy person, and, as we have demonstrated in this video, there are countless cases where the press did not report on it as much, because it was not on a political agenda. How dare Mr. Obama soil their memories, and who they were, and are, by using this and other events for his own purpose? Guns have been used to save lives, and could have been used to save other people. Mr. Obama would have you believe that guns are the cause of these crimes that CNN, Fox, and the rest of mainstream media talk about so much, but it is hardly mentioned when the crimes are committed by authorities that are ever increasingly armed. Mr. Obama will tell you he needs to get guns out of the hands of criminals, but he will be taking them out of the hands of law-abiding citizens, while the criminals will still have them, and will have other means of inflicting harm. The law-abiding citizen will be helpless. Those that were saved by guns will become victims. And those that could have been saved by guns will have that history repeated, as others end up raped and murdered. Mr. Obama, the Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution does not talk about an army, that is covered elsewhere in the Constitution. It does talk about a well-regulated militia, which is made up of civilians with their own weapons. The Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution does not talk about protecting government or government resources, but it does talk about being necessary for the security of a free state. The Second Amendment of the U.S. Constitution does not say a single word about hunting or sport, but it does say,
"The people's right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed."
To the American people, as many laws have been banning firearms in cities such as Chicago, New York, and Washington, D.C., have been implemented, and, as the courts get them, they are now being overthrown as unconstitutional. Even if they were not ruled on, they are an infringement of your Second Amendment rights, and you have no obligation to obey it, and the courts have no obligation to enforce it.
No one is bound to obey an unconstitutional law, and no courts are bound to enforce it.
Mr. Obama, as the chief law enforcement officer of the country, you are responsible for the conduct of those under your command. There will be no further tolerance of any of the following: any act to infringe on any of the Bill of Rights, as identified in the U.S. Constitution; any act to seize or locate any firearms or ammunition; any act to control the ownership of firearms or ammunition; any act to control the manufacturing or sales of firearms or ammunition; any act to document ownership, purchases, or attempts to purchase firearms or ammunition; any act to deploy or stage for deployment any military forces or government employees or agents thereof, for the purpose of asserting control over the population, or the rights of the people, or the states, as defined in the U.S. Constitution, such as would be used in martial law. Any act to write, form, negotiate, enter into, or comply with any international treaty that would or could do any of the points mentioned previously.
Reed versus Covert, 354 U.S. 1, 1957. Treaties do not confer powers not authorized by Constitution.
Any action taken by you to attempt to perform those acts, or similar acts, as interpreted by the American people, or any attempt by you to skirt your responsibility to the true office of the presidency, will be viewed by many people as your willful act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as those acts would be willful disregard of your oath of office. Any further attempt by you, your administration, law enforcement, or those under authority of the presidency to perform or assist in performance with any body attempting such acts will be viewed by many people as your willful act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as those acts would be willful disregard of your oath of office. Any further attempt by you, your administration, law enforcement, or those under authority of the presidency to do any of those acts mentioned or anything similar will be viewed by many people as your willful act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as those acts would be willful disregard of your oath of office. Upon such acts, it is the responsibility of the Vice President and Cabinet members to immediately exercise their authority under the 25th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution to remove you from office. Failure of such act may be viewed as an act of insurrection and treason by the Vice President and Cabinet members, as such failure would be willful disregard of each of their oath of office. Upon failure of the Vice President and Cabinet members to perform such duty of your removal, it then falls on Congress to immediately force your removal by legal means. Failure of any member of Congress to perform such duty, or to hinder it in any way, will be viewed by many people as an act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as such failure would be willful disregard of each person's oath of office. Upon failure of the Congress to perform such duty, it will be the responsibility upon the United States Supreme Court for failure to act in past or present to rectify said situation, and as such, will be viewed by many people as an act of insurrection and treason against the American people, as such failure would be willful disregard of each Supreme Court justice's oath of office. Upon failure of all the aforementioned bodies to perform such duty, it will be the authority and duty of any and all members of the United States Armed Forces to remove the President, Vice President, Cabinet members, and members of Congress, and the U.S. Supreme Court justices from power by military force. Failure by all military members to perform such duties will constitute as an act of civil war against the American people by said authorities.
This video has links to other sources. This is for news and education reasons, and so falls under fair use. But no doubt, some people will try and have it removed. Download it and re-upload it, or pass it along. Let the truth be known.
We are anonymous.
We do not forgive.
We do not forget.
Thank you. there's no point in talking about Linux if I can't edit my videos and record in Linux. I would say the Windows counterpart would be Sony Vegas Pro, and that's saying a lot. Kaden, live.